my name is Adith, and today I'll be talking about nanotechnology in cancer treatment. So first, for some background and the literature review, curing cancer has long been one of the leading scientific pursuits of the medical world. While a cure has not been found, there are several treatment options, including hormone therapy, surgery, bone marrow transplantation, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, radiation, and immunotherapy. Recently, nanotechnology has entered the medical field. Their small diameter and large surface-to-volume ratio gave nanomaterials the unique ability to bind, absorb, and transport substances such as drugs, DNA, proteins, and RNAs. According to a journal, Nanotechnology, the Future Medicine, the potential applications of nanotechnology include fluorescent biological labels, drug delivery, detection of proteins pathogens, tissue engineering, and the purification of biomolecules. More specifically, in cancer, some of the potential applications include nanoparticle drug delivery, photothermal therapy, early diagnosis, tumor detection, and MRI contrast and imaging. So to get into the benefits of nanotechnology treatment compared to traditional, I'll be delving into the literature review. So in nanoparticle drug delivery, nanoparticles are utilized to deliver drugs directly to cancer cells. This reduces side effects on healthy tissues and helps to overcome any drug resistance. Additionally, there's the potential of photothermal therapy, which uses nanoparticles to absorb light to destroy cancer cells. Cancer cells are more sensitive to heat than normal cells, and therefore the treatment destroys the tumor but maintains minimal damage to healthy tissue, unlike radiation and chemo, which damage healthy cells. It can also be used for early cancer diagnosis. Current imaging techniques, such as the ones pictured above, can only examine changes in surface tissue relatively late in progression, but with the use of nanotechnology, it can detect changes at the cellular level, which allows for early detection of diseases. Additionally, nanotech imaging utilizes nanoscale contrasting agents for cancer imaging and diagnosis, which can help with MRI scans. In one foundational source, Cancer Nanotechnology, Current Status and Perspectives, it compares and contrasts conventional versus nanotech cancer treatments, providing insights into applications for cancer drug therapy, diagnostics, imaging, and radiation therapy, elucidating the many benefits of this treatment. In another foundational source, we get the perspectives of four experts in the field for their opinions on how we can fulfill the promise of nanomedicine for the detection, diagnosis, and treatment of patients with cancer. This leads me to my gap in research. As previously explained, there is a host of information and research comparing the efficacy and benefits of nanotech cancer treatments to traditional treatments. While current research delves into the scientific and theoretical benefits of nanotech, few actually delve into its actual application and practicality in a clinic or a hospital. To understand its practicality, we need to explore the medical preferences of medical professionals. This leads to my research goal that aims to compare and contrast how various oncologists view traditional cancer treatment compared to nanotech cancer treatments, comparing factors such as effectiveness, cost, patient outcomes, and side effects. This bridges the knowledge gap and delves into their perspectives and insights. This research project will help to offer a more holistic understanding of the challenges associated with adopting cancer treatment, the practicality of its actual implementation, informs future studies, and guides policymakers and researchers. So getting into my methodology now, I first reached out to oncologists of various specialties from RWJ, knowing that only a few would be able to get back to me. And with those who responded, I performed a semi-structured interview, which is a structure that allows pre-planned questions, but gives the interviewee the chance to elaborate through the use of open-ended questions. After that, to gain a comprehensive understanding of their perspectives, I asked two questions about effectiveness, cost, patient outcomes, side effects, integration into practice, and research and development. I also utilized the four questions from my foundational source as a jumping point to expand on existing knowledge and create my gap. The four questions asked about the disconnect between potential therapy and FDA approval, which I categorized as integration into practice, nanotech opportunities for cancer detection and diagnosis, as well as its advantages, which I categorized as effectiveness, and how to conduct better testing, which I categorized as research and development. I then elaborated on these further, and these were the questions that were asked to the physicians in the interviews addressing each of those factors. So for effectiveness, how do they perceive the overall effectiveness, cases where nanotech would demonstrate superior effectiveness, as well as comparing the side effects of both treatments. For integration into practice, I asked them if they think that nanotech-based treatments should be integrated into practice, and how would they navigate between offering conventional and new treatments. For research and development, what advancements and developments are necessary, and how do you stay informed and inform patients as well? For cost, I asked for a cost comparison and what they believe is to be more cost-effective in the long run. And for patient outcomes, I asked to assess differences in patient outcomes and if there are specific patient populations where one approach is more suitable than the other. So since I utilized the questions in the foundational source as a jumping-off point, I analyzed the pre-existing interviews and the new interviews and conducted a thematic analysis. So a thematic analysis is a method of analysis which determines a relationship between common themes and a sample of collected data. So this thematic analysis was split into three parts. The first part was identifying the major themes in the pre-existing interviews, categorizing their major points and opinions into a corresponding theme. I then conducted a thematic analysis of the physician's answers by summarizing their overall perspectives towards the factors such as effectiveness, cost, etc. And in part three, I took note of any overarching themes and examined any differences in perspectives or similarities. But since I asked more questions than the foundational source, any resultant themes found were not viewed as a difference, but simply an addition. So after this, we now go into my findings and analysis. So firstly, in the pre-existing interviews with Sanitha Bhatia, some of the themes that I found were versatile application of nanotechnology going beyond oncology, evolving applications of nanotech, potential for early cancer detection, and advantages of nanotherapeutics, mostly structural advantages, and the necessity of increased research. Next, in Siwa Chen's interview, I found the theme difficulty integrating into practice because of concerns with the FDA, evolving applications of nanotechnology, again going past oncology, advancements in research and development, and advantages of nanotherapeutics, again structural advantages. In Marina Dobrowski's, I found the themes difficulty integrating into clinical practice, again because of FDA approval and struggles with that, evolving applications of nanotechnology that goes beyond just oncology, advancements in research and development, and advantages of nanotherapeutics. And then finally, in Tara Lammers, I found the themes that was actually different, easy integration into clinical practice, because she felt that 15 have already been introduced and approved, so that theme differed in hers. Evolving applications of nanotechnology, advantages of nanotherapeutics, and advancements in research and development. Now going into the themes found in the physician's answers, in terms of effectiveness, all the physicians believe that nanotechnology is more precision technology and delivers the treatment more precisely to avoid other major side effects. And when asked which potential cases would be this treatment be better suited for, they agreed that it was all major cancers, such as breast cancer or lung cancer, which would be better with this kind of nanotechnology because it could be combined with other pre-existing treatments. When asked about cost, they obviously all agreed that it's going to be incredibly costly, but this cost is dependent on the pharmacy, and they increase the cost, and the government can regulate it to make it more accessible to everyone, but that goes beyond the questions of medicine. But when talked about cost effectiveness as a whole, they believe that it's dependent on cancer type to cancer type. So if it's lung cancer and these new treatments give you 5 to 6 months for a $1 million drug, that's not really cost effective. But if you have another type of cancer, say pancreatic cancer, and this gives you another 2 to 3 years of survival, there is cost effectiveness. So that establishes the cancer subtype to subtype. Now in terms of patient outcomes, they all agreed that it has better survival, efficacy, and safety. They just felt that it was more of a financial toxin compared to traditional therapy. But this financial factor is never a factor when it comes to making a treatment recommendation, because they will give the best therapy in terms of efficacy and safety, regardless of cost. And then when asked about side effects, to compare the side effects of conventional and nanotechnology, chemotherapy and other traditional treatments typically have nausea, vomiting, hair loss, and blood counts being on the lower side, whereas nanotech usually has a better side effect profile because it's more targeted towards cancerous cells, and normal cells are not targeted. but it does have some immune-related side effects, such as thyroid issues and inflammation in the lung. So this is this will not work for anyone who has autoimmune conditions. And then finally, when asked about integration into practice, they said that it all depends on the guidelines and if the NCCN or the National Comprehensive Cancer Institute guidelines make a recommendation, then it'll get incorporated into all the practices. Especially if it is category one or two, then it will be fully integrated into practices. And then finally, for research and development, they all agreed that we need more genomic testing and we need more genetic-based precise drugs that targets mutations rather than just blanket therapies, because not all lung cancers, breast cancers, pancreatic cancers are the same. So more precision medicines are necessary with more genomic testing. And in terms of educating themselves and their patients, they go to national conferences every year, and obviously any new technology all these physicians are in favor of, and educating patients by presenting data, telling them about clinical trials, performance, and the safety profile. So some of the major themes found in these physician interviews was the advantages of nanotherapeutics with minimized side effects and increased survival, application-specific effectiveness, it varies from cancer subtype to cancer subtype, it's not a blanket treatment, economic considerations and accessibility, a patient-centric approach where they prioritize the patient's safety and well-being over cost, difficulty integrating into the practice because it's all dependent on the NCCN guidelines, and if they agree, that's when it affects their treatment recommendations, and advancements in research and development. So some of the commonalities and themes found between the physicians and the experts, which were the PhD professors, etc., were advantages of nanotherapeutics, where both agreed that it had severe advantages, but the experts mostly focused on structural advantages, whereas physicians focused on patient benefits like reduced side effects and increased survival. Also, difficulty integrating in practice. This was a theme that was common in both, but once again had its differences, where experts were talking about the reasons for FDA approvals to be lacking, such as toxicity and cost-wise, whereas doctors simply viewed it as an obstacle that holds them back from their treatment recommendations. And both agreed that advancements in research and development are necessary with increased testing and increased data collection to increase our understanding of nanotechnology. Some differences in themes was the physician saw that there was treatment-specific effectiveness, so it depended more on the type of cancer. It's not just nanotechnology benefits all. They also considered economic considerations and accessibility in the overall treatment process, and they also had a patient-centric approach where all their solutions and all this new treatment was considered in the lens of how will this help the patient and how can we make this new treatment as accessible to the patients as possible. So those were all unique to the physicians, and unique to the PhD experts and professionals was the evolving use of nanotechnology, because they considered it from a wider scope of just normal treatments, and they looked at it beyond oncology, just the evolving use of nanotechnology that goes beyond oncology. So from my findings, I've been able to conclude that doctors have a more patient-centered approach that's focused more on treatment recommendations and based on the type of cancer subtype rather than just broad nanotechnology in general. So some of the limitations that I faced when conducting this was obviously the time constraint. Additionally, the number of participants, because these oncologists are incredibly busy and incredibly renowned. So although I reached out to several, only a few were able to get back to me and actually respond. So that also led to response bias, because only there was some non-response from those who I reached out to. And obviously the changing field, nanotechnology, and the medical field in general, is continuously advancing, and there's consistent new advancements being made all around. So it's important to continuously reassess these assumptions. And then for implications, the proposed study highlights the need for personalized treatment plans that combines both approaches depending on cancer type, elucidated by the doctor's perspectives. Also, as supported by many physicians, it can help in developing regulatory frameworks that balance innovation with safety and efficacy, and push for regulation to allow for more accessibility. Also, it can improve innovation and research by informing future studies and research, because an emphasis has been placed by both experts and physicians to increase genomic testing, which will guide the allocation of targeted improvements. And finally, it will serve as a model for future interdisciplinary collaboration by bringing together diverse perspectives and collaborations. So this is why we're excited.
Okay, my question for you is, how is the method or process you chose aligned with the purpose of your research?
So,
which methods did you consider and reject?
So, as I was saying before, the method I chose was a semi-structured interview, and I thought this was the most optimal choice of data collection because it did have, like, it allowed me as a researcher to guide the focus of the interviews, but also it made sure that the physicians were all allowed to elaborate and explain their different viewpoints, because obviously when you're getting data from a lot of different people, I don't want to limit their expression or their different ideas. So the semi-structured interview was the best way to go for me. I also based it on the Foundational Source 2, as I discussed before, where they also had a semi-structured interview, and I found that worked very well, except they had not analyzed it, they just listed out all the answers. And I did consider using a survey or some other type of method, but I didn't want these physicians' answers to be constrained to a number choice or a multiple choice, so I wanted to make sure they could elaborate fully.
Thank you. Which of the various perspectives you explored was the most difficult for you to incorporate into your research inquiry, and why?
Sorry, can you repeat?
Sure. Which of the various perspectives you explored was the most difficult for you to incorporate into your research inquiry, and why?
So, of the various perspectives that I explored, I would say the experts' opinions were difficult to integrate because my original focus was specifically on oncologists and their viewpoints and their viewpoints on integrating nanotechnology into practice itself, but I still wanted to integrate the perspectives of some of the foundational sources I read. So the experts did have very differing opinions from the physicians, as shown in the slideshow when I was covering differences of themes. So because they had such different opinions, at first I struggled with how to integrate them both into my research question, but then I was able to come up with a conclusion that I would use this as comparing and contrasting between the physicians and the experts, and use both the similarities that I found and the differences I found as conclusions as part of my research.
Thank you. Think about the initial curiosity that led to your inquiry. What other areas of inquiry might the same curiosity lead to?
So the initial curiosity that led to my inquiry was that I aspire on going into the medical field, and in addition to going into the medical field, not only do I want to be a practicing doctor, but I look towards medical innovation in the future. So that kind of led me towards nanotechnology, and that led me towards looking at the perspectives of oncologists towards this new technology. And that similar inquiry, that similar curiosity fostered by a love of medicine and medical innovation might lead me to future inquiries looking at things like robotic surgery or AI in medicine or other similar new and up and coming prospects in the medical field.
Any other questions? Audience? No? All right. Thank you.